fundraising, we kind of thought it would be good to then look at a different angle. So I'm very pleased to say that we have Fraser Brand here, chairman of the ACT Foundation from Switzerland, who's going to talk about blockchain as a force for social good. Thank you.
It's good to be here. So we're actually flipping from that kind of horrifying 30 minutes of everything evil and that could go wrong to take a look at how blockchain and this technology can be harvested for good. We'll start with something very simple. Get your eyeballs around that one. And these are all the opportunities for blockchain. In smart contracts, digital currency, record keeping, securities, some of the players involved in that. And we've been looking at this technology from a very business perspective, an investment perspective, a lot in the last 24 hours. So where does social good fit into this whole thing? I think that's a very interesting concept. And I want to start by saying, that this is not going to be some sort of twee thing about, can we do some charity crowdfunding or a bit of good here and there. I really want to, if you'll allow me, get into the how do we save the planet through blockchain question. How do we change everything? How do we fix the trajectory that we're on using this technology or by harnessing parts of it? So let's go there and not be scared and just see how we get on. We'll stay on the topic of blockchain companies initially, because I really want to, because that's the sort of theme of the conference, I really want to look at what's happened, the fundraising around blockchain companies, and how it might apply to this concept and this topic of blockchain for social good. Well, many people have seen this, Mugayar and Quadricle. It's a very interesting concept. It starts off here with everybody, and then projects move here, and then they go to here, and then here. And it identifies darkness is, of course, where the project really has nothing. They have an idea, they have a white paper. And of course, up here they've got something, and then they migrate to here. And with this amazing world of initial coin offerings or token offerings, you get this huge influx of money to quite an inexperienced team. And if they're a really decentralized organization, there's not much option for them to raise money through equity later, so they have to make it last. But they have to go along this path. And that's the risk that what are increasingly be called investors, but of course, which many ICOs call donators, are taking. So that's the sort of bigger picture of token launches. And I really relate to a comment that one of the panelists made about the kind of, inadequacy of some of the reporting and some of the publication about blockchain that started to happen as more and more people swell into the thing. We're starting to get sort of blanket ideas like this, that wow, look at how much money's been raised through cryptocurrency, and it really doesn't tell the whole story. This article is saying, ICOs went like that, then there was a dip, and now they come back. But what they're not doing is they're not talking about what's changed in the middle here. What's the makeup of that bar? And that's where this sort of analysis comes in very, very handy. So obviously this gives a lot more meat to be careful not to fall off the stage. A bit more meat to that previous slide, okay? So here we have, June through to September and what happened. These guys, are real household names. Many of you will be familiar with them. And here we start getting the problems. Here you have the company that did an ICO raised less than $1 billion, which is 7% of what they wanted to raise. How likely are they to get through that quadrangle and to succeed? And what happens to the contributor's money in that instance?
Just give me a minute to digest this. I think Kin is kind of an exception to the rule. They're quite late to the ICO craze, but they still did quite well. But actually, I think their goal was 150 million. I think if Kin had launched there, they would have raised 100 million, 150 million in 4 minutes. I think it's completely changed. So there are radical changes happening to ICOs. We're talking quite blanket terms in this conference about them, about blockchain and fundraising. And some of what's been said feels to me a bit like trying to shoehorn this new innovation into what exists today, how we run exchanges and so on. But this is changing extremely fast. And of course, this is the sort of brighter story in this ICO mix. Of course, there are some fantastic token economic models, but there are increasingly, utterly, ridiculous token ideas. And this has sort of heralded a lot of rigor, which is very welcome. This is a Swiss law firm's view on what a kind of taxonomy of blockchain crypto properties. Here you have Wings, Gnosis, and Golem, our application tokens. And then they start to try to define what are these tokenization of relative rights and claims, stakeholders' rights, and then co-ownership. I mean, actually, these pure, real token economics models are quite hard to come up with. And what you're finding more and more, and if you think back to that graph that I showed you about the number of ICOs, if you think of the number of ICOs that there were 4 or 5 months ago and those companies, they really were very sophisticated, well worked out, and very sort of profoundly game-changing models. Whereas in September, the proportion of that chart or that bar, the great majority of those would just be, rubbish. And not really token economic models at all. When I moderated a panel yesterday, I quoted a lot of quotes, and they were some sort of notable people in the sector. I'm not going to go through them all, but I think it's really good to highlight, because I want to shift to where did this blockchain world and community come from? What are these people like? What's in their mind? I mean, look at some of these statements. Individual power to control personal data and wealth will increase while government influence will diminish. Shapeshift, anybody in cryptocurrency will have used it. Cryptocurrencies will outcompete and displace government currencies. Governments will lose the ability to conjure money out of thin air. That guy is furious about the way money is created by governments and the plight that has put us in. And when we look at the topic of blockchain for social good, it's not some tweet like, can we fund this sort of poor situation, health person, charity sort of thing. There are much, much bigger topics at stake. These people want to change everything. They want to decentralize everything, and they want to change the game thoroughly from end to end. Financial institutions will no longer be necessary. Former federal prosecutor. Very hard-hitting one. Every asset will be a blockchain, allowing anyone from Afghanistan Zimbabwe to create their own wealth in a world where nation-state jurisdictions are a thing of the past. Very extreme. But my point is, where are these people coming from, this blockchain community? What are they trying to do? This whole thing about ICOs, where did it come from?
why was it so successful? You had companies that said, right, we're going to take something like insurance, we're going to take something like advertising, we're going to take these things and we're going to completely change them, and we're going to raise the money in 4 minutes. And they did raise the money in 4 minutes. Why? Because thousands of people wanted to, you know, make 10 or 20%? Or was it more because thousands of people wanted to change everything? This is the question. What do these people want? I want to stop proprietary control of global networks by private interests. I hate it. They've got control. I want to know that the food I eat is not destroying forests and the clothes I wear are slavery free. Supply chains on blockchain. I want to take back control of how I'm advertised to, and I want a media that I can trust. You know, he's got kids, my boy's 10 years old. Do you know what I really, really dislike? He comes to me and says, Dad, you know, there's a this game, you know, there's a special offer on it. I can get a half price. It's really, really good. And if we act now, we can get it. We can get 7% off. But we have to buy it for the end of the day. Okay. You know, and he's been advertised to. You know, and some of the blockchain projects that raised money so fast were really targeting that and challenging that and helping this person. I don't want to be advertised to like this. I don't want that level. I want to have more control. So I'm trying to sort of paint a picture of a slightly different picture of this, and perhaps a slightly more positive one. You know, I just want an alternative to banks, especially when it comes to sending money abroad. And I know this is quite a sort of a banker audience and so on, but you know, for people like this, the banking crisis is very raw. I mean, it may be ancient history, but people in general are like, you know what? You absolutely trashed everything, threatened everything through reckless handling of money. And people are not forgetting that. And these people want change. So these are the things that are driving blockchain, I think. Now, when it comes to ICOs, you know, there has been a lot of talk about, you know, even from the lawyers, like how to, you know, what's the recourse if an ICO goes south, if it doesn't work out, if it's abandoned and so on. But a lot of people signing up and paying to ICOs, they basically signed a document about 10 to 12 pages long saying, you know, I agree to give you this money. I know it could be abandoned. I know it could be hacked. I know that the technology could be made redundant. I know that this is the most riskiest thing that I will ever do. And they signed it. You know, why? Because of this, you know, desire to make money, to double up. Sure, that's what came next, because people were doubling up. But the thing underlying it and driving it was, I believe, a desire to change, decentralize, and get back control. And now we'll flip to, you know, more of the positive side of this topic, like what can we really do and so on. You know, not beating around the bush. The future is, you know, is very fraught, and obviously our children, you know, above anything else that we want to sort of leave a planet and leave a future for them. Okay. I didn't mention at the start, but my day job as a consultant is work with governments and conservation organizations, the International Union for Conservation of Nature, and climate change and food security in different countries. From Uganda on one side to Southeast Asia and Vietnam on the other, all types of countries and so on. So I work in that sector, and I you know, with the climate agreement that America sort of famously pulled out of recently, thanks to Donald Trump. But this is the bottom line, you know, in terms of global warming. The sort of COP20 pledges were around there. That was pre COP21. Then countries come up with what they call INDCs, which is their commitments, which take us to this trajectory. And that's what our 2-degree trajectory looks like. I'm very involved with some countries and how they came up with these INDCs. And I can tell you that in many cases, it's not very high level. I can can tell you in many cases it's just a committee. And I can tell you in many cases it's seen as an opportunity to get more grant money from donors. We're in big trouble here. We really are. How are we really going to move this as fast as it needs to move? Like, that's the question. I mean, never mind these sort of little social good causes. How can blockchain fix this? And the ACT Foundation that I founded and is based in Switzerland, currently, Gibraltar, but it sort of was inspired out of this model. So there's the state on one hand, and then there's the citizen on the other hand. This is World Bank material, actually. And it said there's always an imbalance between the state and the citizen. And it says that the only way that we can really change that is by empowering citizens, citizen mobilization, and getting better information into the hands of citizens. There's this great thing called social accountability. It means the extent and capability of citizens to hold the state accountable and to make it responsive to their needs. People who want change, people who don't want corporate control, people who don't want corporates running our governments, who want to decentralize, people who want climate change sorted out, and people who want a future for their children. And this was what inspired the idea of the ACT platform that we're currently building. Thanks to a pre-ICO, and thanks to 472 people who signed who signed one of those 12-page documents, highlighting the risks involved. People who want change. I'll tell you a bit about it really quick. We have this now. It's a voting app. It's an Ethereum smart contract. At the moment, it's on the test net. People can buy test Ether. They can purchase votes. And then they apply these votes to causes. The platform is capitalized by these purchases of votes. This is not a small idea, it's a big idea. It's a decentralized funding platform for activism, essentially, for citizen mobilization. On the other side, where the ACT token fits in, there's a curation engine. So we've decentralized this big problem with charities and so on, and foundations in general. Is that often, you know, there's a sort of 6 months lag, and eventually the decision is made from a committee. Anybody who has used Steemit will know about kind of how you can decentralize this sort of curation process. So here, curators are paid in accordance with how much curation they do of proposals, and also how many ACT tokens they owe. The revenue model of the capitalized pool that comes from citizens buying votes, 80% is used to pay proposals, 15% curators. So actually, unlike many token economic models where the value of the token is somehow tied to network effect and community size, in our case, there's a big healthy revenue model in Ether in there as well. And then 5% to keep the foundation going in its marketing efforts. But basically here, smart contracts come in so that once a proposal is curated, to a certain level, it's pushed to the voting application where the thousands and hopefully millions and maybe a billion people say, yes, we want that to happen, and a smart contract pays the proposal maker. And we'll need to put AML criteria in here as sort of one signature in a smart contract. And we're heading towards a decentralized autonomous organization, which is very, very interesting in the concept of the challenges the world faces. That challenge I showed you, that graph of climate change, the pace at which governments are moving, the need, the sheer scale of need for mobilization of people to move this faster, to move it as fast as it will move, that's going to rustle a lot of feathers, ruffle a lot of feathers. And so potentially this could be a decentralized autonomous organization. Couldn't be stopped, inhibited, shut down. The flow of money could move at any speed and at any scale to drive change. And that's it on the ACT Foundation. It's an interesting model. It could drive change in many, many areas. Let's jump to money. I'm going to read this out. I think there's quite a lot of money people in the room. They may be familiar with this theory. Within the global financial system, fiat money is used as a store of value and means of exchange. This fiat money is in fact interest-bearing debt issued largely by banks, the use of which creates systemic, perverse incentives for unsustainable use of natural resources. This is because, firstly, money as debt privileges financial value over environmental value, thereby creating an incentive for production of financial capital, but not the production of environmental capital. Secondly, interest repayable on debt acts as an internal motor for the consumption of ever more natural resources, leading to the overutilization of topsoils and forests, which present a problem for human welfare in the context of finite resource base. And I really welcome the opportunity to hit this topic at a venue and an event like this, because we can and we should be asking questions about money itself. Because in talking about currencies, we're talking about changing money. And as I hope you see in the next few slides, we may have an opportunity of a once in a millennium chance to change it in such a way that fixes these problems. This is interesting. This is a project that's been developed in Ghana and in Uganda. There's a lot of talk about putting smallholder farmers on blockchains and financing everybody in the world. Let's do it. How many tons of soil flow into the rivers in Rwanda each year? Every single year, tons of soil running off smallholder farmland into rivers. 20 million tons of soil. The water is red. Those farms have a life expectancy of about 18 years. Let me tell you something quite sobering. If we get money, crypto money, whatever way, into the hands of those farmers right now faster, they will buy more fertilizer and they will degrade that land faster. We need to be smarter about this, and I just want to point out that sobering truth. This is an innovative financial mechanism that's being piloted in Rwanda, where farmers can initially lend about $20, but there's conditions. So it's contingent credit. They have to plant a strip of grass which prevents runoff of soil. When they do that, they graduate to the next level where they can borrow more, but then they have to demonstrate that they planted trees in this grass, and so on, until they get up to the level where they can afford a cow. But what we've done in this model, and it's endorsed by all these people, what we've done in this model is we've baked in environmental criteria to loan conditions. And as a matter of fact, for banks and financial institutions, these loans represent less risky loans because they're tied to less risky farms. Okay? But this is the sort of new thinking and paradigm change that we need. Now this is relevant in the next few slides of this discussion. Today, the role of money creation sits with commercial banks. This is something that can change in the advent of central bank cryptocurrency. As soon as they lend money, right, a new deposit is credited, and therefore new money is created in the economy. In a blockchain-enabled world, incidentally, the source of this is here. It's very worth looking up. In a blockchain-enabled world, central banks could be predominant lenders of central bank cryptocurrency to commercial banks on a matched basis. The central bank would become the creator of money, and commercial banks would play a role of credit or origination engines, passing on the money from central bank to those they deem creditworthy. Imagine a world in which banks are not deposit-taking institutions, and the only source of funding for banks is from central bank or through the issuance of bonds. I believe that central bank cryptocurrencies could be absolutely game-changing. As soon as a loan is made by a commercial bank, it would be deposited onto some blockchain, so direct liability of the central bank. Such a system would require central banks to lend to commercial banks on an unsecured basis. Now let's go back to our model of smallholder farming, where their loans are contingent on sustainable practice. And let's bring in the latest Bloomberg recommendations for financial institutions that they need to disclose on carbon and climate risk and the sustainability of their portfolios. What if, at a government and country level, an interest rate could be levied on all money based on how sustainable that money was to be used? And the proceeds of that interest rate could be used to fund reforestation and other initiatives at a local level that would make a country more sustainable and help us all as a planet. This is the sort of thing that blockchain can achieve, and this is the sort of once in a millennium opportunity that we might have. Why wouldn't the central banks issue cryptocurrencies? It makes abundant sense. Increases transparency, reduces credit settled risk, increases stability of the banking system. This is happening. I mentioned the crypto ruble rest yesterday. But there is an opportunity to sort of build in the value of natural capital, which has been excluded from the entire financial system up until now. And so finally, we'll come to a sort of quirky idea that isn't happened, but it is being floated. In fact, it was kind of pitched at a World Bank conference in London a few weeks ago. But one of the things that needs to happen if we're to survive is that we need to reforest this planet. Okay? Renewable energy is going to get sorted out. You know, in some cases, it's going to be, you know, dragging it into existence. In other cases, it's going to be welcomed with open arms, all the opportunities that it brings. Agriculture is a much more difficult thing. Food security and food production is a much more challenging area. And one of the really big wins that's out there is the possibility of reforestation. In terms of degraded land, which is basically useless and could be reforested with a huge gigaton carbon sequestration win per year, there's about 350 million hectares ready to go. But I know more than anyone, because it's my job to come up with financial instruments to get that done. And that, you know, one day I'm dealing with the potential for a sovereign green bond, and the next day we're looking at a blended finance instrument. Very, very difficult. I believe that we need to sort of change, do something game-changing, and change the economics of trees to make this happen. Guys, we need to do this. It's actually not an option. We need to get trees into those 350 million hectares of land. And how are we going to do it? I mean, we could do it with a cryptocurrency. That cryptocurrency, we could call it tree. It could be tied to that mechanism where that interest rate on money is used to fund it. This could happen. I encourage you as people in the crypto community to dream big and embrace these ideas for social good in cryptocurrency. It's not just about making the big money. There are bigger opportunities. Now, what can we do in terms of reforestation? Instead of just taking money and doing reforestation projects, we could actually operate on an output-based basis. So let's say that we have smallholders in Uganda and want to plant shea trees. A lot of them were cut down when people returned from war and they needed money fast. And the best way to get money was to cut down shea trees, which of course very high value with shea butter, and turn them into charcoal. But now we can replant those shea trees. What we could do here is they could plant a tree, and then in 1 year's time they could take a photo of that tree. And this could be a blockchain-enabled app. That photo could be verified by other people, call them curators. And it could be a project design and implementation component. The cryptocurrency, the smart contract, could issue the cryptocurrency on those verification events. And suddenly we get this output-based mechanism for global reforestation. And this cryptocurrency, you know, there's been a lot of talk about cryptocurrencies, you know. Look at the Ripple, a $25 billion, $15 billion war chest. You've got Dash sitting there with 26 million for innovative ideas. I mean, these things are great. These aren't just small fly-by-night operations now. These guys have real muscle. Look at that with Dash with 26 million to spend. Compare that to Y Combinator that spends about 1.2 million a year. I think it's 26 million to spend on innovation right now. These things are great.
Cryptocurrency could drive reforestation. And that really is my concluding note. Think big. It is possible to change everything. Social good, as I said at the start, I'm not talking about a little bit of charity here, a little bit of charity there.
I'm talking about a future for that child that says, I want a future. It is possible through blockchain. But these are the ideas. And I thank you very much for your time. I welcome questions, but I think our time is pretty much done.
There are time for questions if anybody would like.
Yeah, I have a question.
Okay, I'm just get a microphone for you.
As long as it's not too different.
I was just thinking about the accountability of those projects funded through the ACT platform.
Yeah.
How do you follow up that they actually proceed with their goals, and do you have some kind of milestone approach to that, so they get more funds as they progress towards their final goal?
Yeah, it's a really good question. It was one of the real challenges that we had. So there's two parts to the answer. The first one is that a second smart contract, the funding contract, will be produced, and it will be a multi-signature. So it will require a signature from the local proposal maker and a signature from, say, for example, a law firm. Locally, I mean, this is a work in progress, but they can verify identity, verify that the money is not going to be used for terrorist activities and so on. In terms of their credibility, we have to rethink crowdfunding a little. I mean, and rethink development as a whole. These are not going to be $1 million grants, all right? I mean, activists, when communities get behind change, generally it's at a quite small level and numbers grow. Incidentally, there's a fascinating statistic that if the movement grows to 3.5% of the population, the government, since 1900, has always had to give way and give the people what they want and what they need. So, you know, it is possible to build these, but it's done slowly. So there's kind of a reputation profile system for proposal makers. Say they receive $1,000 the first time, that will sort of be recorded as a successful project. And you'll be able to see that they were successful and used the money well. It doesn't really answer your question, because what if they just fritter away that $1,000? We kind of feel that that's not a great risk, but you know. Because the curators, you know, are heavily incentivized through that 15% to ask really drilling questions and to get to the bottom of how the money will be used. You see, in every way, we're trying to get away from centralizing something, from somebody sitting in an office deciding whether that will be done or not.